Good morning. Glad to be with you this morning. My name is Laura Ossie, and I'm here this Sunday and next Sunday, although next Sunday I think Pastor Nissa and I will be a team, so she can have a week off. I'm going to preach, and then she can just show up and lead worship. So this is my first time to Chatfield. I'm really glad to be here with you. My call is through Gustavus. But I am a pastor to pastors. I actually organize and implement continuing education for pastors in southern Minnesota. So I'm grateful to be a colleague with your pastor, and what a fantastic pastor you have. So I'm grateful to know her and that she asked me to be here today while she's on a mission trip. So I'm glad to be with you and honored to lead worship together in our Savior Jesus Christ. Would you please stand? Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the God of manna, the God of miracles, the God of mercy. Amen. Drawn to Christ and seeking God's abundance, let us confess our sin. God, our provider, help us. It is hard to believe there is enough to share. Question your ways when they differ from the ways of the world in which you live. We turn our own understanding rather than trusting you. We take offense at your teachings and your ways. Turn us again to you. Where else can we turn? Share with us the words of eternal life and feed us for the life of the world. Beloved people of God, in Jesus, the manna from heaven, you are fed and nourished. By Jesus, the worker of miracles, there is always more than enough. Through Jesus, the bread of life, you are shown God's mercy. You are forgiven and loved into abundant life. Amen. Let us sing our hymn of the day, All Who Hunger.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Gracious God, you have placed within the hearts of all your children a longing for your word and a hunger for your truth. Grant that we may know your Son to be the true bread of heaven and share the bread with all the world. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated. I want to invite the kids to come on up. Good morning, everybody. How are you doing? Are you awake? Maybe? No, yeah, me either. I was wondering, when you go to the doctor, how do they measure how much you weigh? What happens? How do they figure that out? What happens? You stand on a scale, right? And then how do they measure how tall you are? With measuring tape, yeah, inches and feet. They figure out how tall you are, how much you weigh. Okay, so we've got a measuring tape and we've got a scale. I was wondering what your ideas would be about how we would measure how much God loves us. What do you think we would use? Do you think a measuring tape? You think a scale? You think a scale? Yeah, you know what? It's really hard to measure how much God loves us. You know why? Because God's love would break the scale, and there's not enough measuring tape in the whole world to measure how much God loves you. Did you know that? God's love would break the scale, and there's not enough tape to measure because God loves you so much, we can hardly come up with a system to even show you how. But I want to point to one thing. What's on the back wall of your beautiful church here? What is that symbol back there? A cross. That is one way that shows the measure of how much God loves us. Now, do you know why I tell you this today? Well, partly because it's my job, because I'm a pastor. But the other reason I tell you today is we're about to hear a story, and we're going to hear a story about a kid. And a kid who's in with a whole bunch of people, thousands of people. And this kid has two loaves of bread and five fish. And that's not enough to feed 5,000 people, right? You've seen two loaves of bread before, right? And five fish, and guess what? It's enough. And you know, even know what? There are 12 baskets of leftovers at the end of it all. Can you believe that? So, when you think that maybe you're too little to do something, or that that you don't know if you can do something, God can do it in ways that will surprise us, because there's always enough with God. There always is. Will you say a prayer with me? And let's do a repeat after me prayer, okay? Dear God, thank you for loving me. I love you. Thank you for showing me how much you love me. Amen. Thank you for coming up today, everybody. You can head back to your seats. My name is Laura. What's your name? Nice to meet you. My name is Laura. You're five? I'm Laura. What's your name? Would you please stand for the reading of the gospel? Jesus went to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, also called the Sea of Tiberias. A large crowd kept following him because they saw the signs that he was doing for the sick. Jesus went up the mountain and sat down there with his disciples. Now the Passover, the festival of the Jews, was near. When he looked up and saw a large crowd coming toward him, Jesus said to Philip, "Where are we to buy bread for these people to eat?" And he said this to test him, for he himself knew what he was going to do. Philip answered him, 6 months' wages would not buy enough bread for each of them to get a little. One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, "There is a boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. But what are they among so many people?" Jesus said, "Make the people sit down." Now there was a great deal of grass in the place, so they sat down, about 5,000 in all. Then Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to those who were seated. So also the fish, as much as they wanted. When they were satisfied, he told his disciples, "Gather up the fragments left over, so that nothing may be lost." So they gathered them up, and from the fragments of the 5 barley loaves left by those who had eaten, they filled 12 baskets. When the people saw the sign that he had done, they began to say, "This is indeed the prophet who has come into the world." When Jesus realized that they were about to come and take him by force to make him king, he withdrew again to the mountain by himself. When evening came, his disciples went down to the sea, got into a boat, and started across the sea to Capernaum. And it was now dark, and Jesus had not yet come to them. The sea became rough because a strong wind was blowing. When they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus walking on the sea coming near the boat, and they were terrified. But he said to them, "It is I. Do not be afraid." Then they wanted to take him into the boat, and immediately the boat reached the land toward which they were going. This is the gospel of our Lord. You may be seated. So I've had this song stuck in my head all week as I prepared this sermon, as this story from John has lived in my imagination. And this lyric has stuck out to me, and it goes like this. "A miracle's a miracle, even when it's ordinary. We will walk on the water, even though it seems scary. If someone would show us the way." And I got to be thinking about ordinary miracles. And then I remembered my friend Katie from seminary and an amazing ordinary miracle that she experienced. So she was part of a group from Luther Seminary that traveled to Haiti back in January of 2010, and that was when the earthquake happened. Now, none from that group were hurt, and they made it home safely just a week or so later. But in the in-between time of the earthquake and when they left for home, they were sitting among thousands out in an open field. The field had gone on forever and ever, and yet they felt like they were elbow to elbow with one another. They didn't know when they would eat, or if they would eat, or what they would eat. They didn't know when they would leave, in the next 24 hours, or in a few days, or a few weeks. They were deeply grateful to be alive, and yet they were afraid. So as they sat in this field with thousands of others, suddenly there were bananas, and Katie was suddenly holding a banana in her hand. And as she worked to tuck it into her bag, thinking that she would ration it out for herself and save it over this amount of time, she looked up and saw a woman seated across from her. And in the blink of an eye, the woman had peeled the banana and pieced it into so many pieces and handed it out without even a look up to who she was handing the banana to. The banana was gone, and people were fed. And Katie was thunderstruck at the simple action of sharing in the face of such fear and uncertainty about when there would be more, or if there would be more. She was ashamed at her white-knuckling onto this banana when she knew she would leave this place to go to a land where there is plenty of food, and the woman across from her would not. A miracle's a miracle, even when it's ordinary. The earthquake that rocked Haiti was anything but ordinary. It was devastating. The fact that this group from the seminary survived is anything but ordinary. The fact that so many died in one fell swoop is anything but ordinary. And yet eating is so very ordinary, isn't it? And Jesus knows this. You'll notice from the reading that he didn't say, "How on earth will these people ever eat?" He didn't say, "It's not my job to figure this out," or, "I'm too tired." He didn't say, "We can't dip into our reserve money for this." No, he just asks Philip, "Where are we to buy bread for these people to eat?" And then, knowing he's not sending anyone to any local store to buy food, news is shared that there is some food. But it's not good news, Jesus. We've got 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. Rather, I suspect it was more a nervous, twitchy, "Well, there's a kid. He's got 5 loaves and 2 fish." And then this happens, and it's one of my favorite parts of the scripture. I don't know why, but Jesus is like, "Tell everybody to sit down." Just sit down. I think maybe he was tired of the disciples being in his face telling him how this would never work. And he says, "Okay, let's go get this miracle started. Go have the people sit down." And so the people sit. And it totally worked. Those 5 barley loaves, those 2 fish among thousands, there were 12 baskets of leftovers. There were leftovers from this "there will never be enough" situation. And so after an astounding afternoon of eating with 5,000 people on the grass when they thought it wasn't possible, the disciples drag themselves back to the boat and head toward home. Maybe they were tired of all of the shenanigans that you get when you follow Jesus. Did they see Jesus depart and head for the mountains to be alone? Did they leave Jesus behind on purpose when they got into the boat? Or did they figure, as usual, he was mobbed by people? Maybe they thought, "Well, he deserves a break. We'll just go." And once in the boat, don't you wonder, didn't they talk about what had just happened? About how cool the afternoon was, or how they'd been distracted by the improbability of it all? Maybe they talked about the people they sat with and met that day and ate with. Or maybe they were grousing about Jesus, about all the ways in which he challenges and tests them. And then they realized they'd been rowing for 3 or 4 miles. And as the weariness set into their bones, and now the wind picked up and the sea was choppy, it felt like maybe they couldn't make it to shore. And then, of course, here comes Jesus, walking on water. And, you know, you realize what he didn't say to them. He didn't say, "Hey, guys, you left without me." He didn't say, "Where do you think you're going?" He didn't say, "Hey, you know, your voices carry over open water. I've heard all your complaints." No, in typical Jesus fashion, Jesus says, "Hey, guys, it's me. Don't be afraid." Now, I imagine that you and I gathered here today, we lead pretty ordinary lives. But you know, our ordinary lives are filled with everyday miracles. The miracle of waking up to a new day, breathing in and out. The miracle that is seeing your child learn something right in front of your very eyes. The miracle of family and friends loving you after you have shared the truth about yourself or opened up about your failings or had a bad day. Or how about The miracle of feeling better in the midst of being sick, or the smile of a stranger in a long, frustrating line. How about the miracle of gainful employment? The miracle of a soothing word from a frazzled spouse. And in the tumult of everyday living, we get distracted by the constant, endless rowing and the wind that won't die down. We can get wearied from the waves battering up against our lives, trying to push us back, overwhelming us with noise and constant motion. We lose our way in the dark night, and we forget to look up for miracles, for Jesus walking right there in front of us. So we've all witnessed today an ordinary miracle in today's reading from John. A bunch of hungry people were fed from the likes of a small boy with bread and fish. And you also witnessed the disciples finding the shore amidst a storm. Well, we might say all those people sitting down to eat from such a small offering of food, it must have caused everyone to share what little they had stowed in their pockets. What kind of miracle is that? Well, we might say Jesus was probably on the shore and it was dark and the disciples were scared and disoriented, so they didn't realize that they were so close to the shore the whole time. I mean, Jesus probably didn't walk on water, right? It's a miracle that we remember who it is we follow, and that Jesus uses each of us, bumbling, normal, forgetful, doubtful, stingy, beautiful humans who don't share well and want to hide what it is we have and get even more. And then we get so worried about what it is we have that we don't think we have enough or anything at all. And Jesus bursts through our clouded vision, through the crushing waves and the roar of the storm, and grounds us, helps us find our shore. He says, "I'm here. Don't be afraid. Put down your fear. We can walk on the water even though it seems scary if someone will show us the way. We just have to look up." And miracles happen when we follow Jesus instead of following our primal instinct of fear. Jesus busts through our shrugged shoulders and ho-hum attitude and transforms everything. The loaves and the fish are changed. The people are changed. We are changed. Because Jesus doesn't show up to make us feel good. No, Jesus silences the growling of our primal fear as he reveals to us that we can be filled through filling others, through opening our hands, relaxing our grip, and receiving what we do not expect. The miracle is not how it happens, but that it happens at all. That in the midst of not enough, there is plenty, leftovers even. Somehow what Jesus chooses to take up and bless is enough, including you and me. It is not if, but when. When we remember who it is we follow, we suddenly find ourselves back on solid ground. It is not if, but when. When we remember who it is we follow, we see miracles all around us every single day. It is not if, but when. When we put down our fear and follow Jesus out into choppy waters and onto solid ground, into fields of scarcity that burst with enough, we find our very selves changed. We are fed, and we can feed others. It's a miracle, an everyday, ordinary miracle that you and I get to do together through the power of Jesus. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let's sing together What Feast of Love. Would you please stand? Let us confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered death on Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit,
church,
the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Rooted in Christ and sustained by the Spirit, we offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all of creation. We pray for the church. Bless the ministries of our neighboring congregations in Chatfield and our synod, as well as our global neighbors and our partners in Colombia and Tanzania. Kindle in us the spirit of collaboration, that all people may know your loving works. Hear us, O God. We pray for creation. Send rain to lands experiencing drought and come to the aid of those enduring sweltering heat. Nurture crops grown for the nourishment of animals and people. Conserve creation and bless it to abundance. Hear us, O God. We pray for those who govern. Cast out arrogance, selfishness, and corruption. Instill compassion and humility in all who lead. Inspire leaders with a vision of the common good and a commitment to ensure that all who hunger are fed. Hear us, O God. We pray for those bowed down by heavy burdens, those who are unemployed or underemployed, those unable to find affordable housing, and those without health insurance. Console those who grieve and hear the cries of all those who call to you for healing. Today we pray especially for Tim, Erica, Darlene, Jack, Tom, Dick, Weston, Carol, Gary, Mary Ann, Kenny, Nathaniel, Paul, Oliver, Rosemary, Peg, Debbie, Ashley, and Oren. We pray for those we lift before you now. Hear us, O God. We pray for the 15 youth and adults traveling to Nashville to be God's hands and feet through service, learning, and love. Keep them safe. Help them know your presence. Bless their journey. Hear us, O God. We lift these and all our prayers to you, O God, confident in the promise of your saving love through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
May the peace of Christ be with you always. Are you sharing a sign of that peace now or not? Are you just waving? Okay, I wasn't sure. So please share whatever you're comfortable doing with one another. Peace to you. You may be seated. I believe there are a few announcements.
Good morning. I'm Mark Johnsrud. I'm currently serving as our council president, and I have some exciting news this morning. Due to a lot of hard work that our call committee has put in place, they have offered the call of the senior pastor, and that was accepted. This was presented at our executive council meeting this week, and the executive council also approved this decision. So the next step in the process is to have a congregational meeting. That will be 2 weeks from today on August 8th at 9:45 a.m. And that's where the congregation will get to see a biography of the pastor and his family. And we will have a vote then at that day to hopefully approve that call. So again, that meeting is August 8th at 9:45 a.m. So it'll be right after worship finishes 2 weeks from today. Two other announcements Pastor Nissa wanted me to stress. Please make a card for someone at the care center at the table in the narthex. These will go on meal trays when residents have to eat in their rooms due to construction in the cafeteria. And also another note that Pastor Nissa is away on the mission trip. The group will return on July 31st. Contact Michelle in the office if you have a pastoral care need, and she will connect you with Pastor Dan, who is covering for us. Thanks.
Would you please stand? Is there an offertory prayer printed? I don't have one in my bulletin. Do you take an offering or do you leave it at the door? Okay, thank you. Let's pray together the prayer our Lord has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Let's sing our sending song.